Good evening, everyone. Welcome to yet another round of Edelweiss Connect. This time, it's a very interesting and a historical connect. We are here to witness something really momentous in the history of Indian debt mutual funds. You know that Edelweiss is known for bringing products or bringing solutions which are really close to people's problems, solving them, and making a lot their lives a lot better. So with that objective in mind, we are here to talk about our new product offering, Edelweiss PSU Bond Plus SDL Index Fund. During the course of next 45 to 60 minutes, we will discuss the products in detail. But before that, let me introduce you and invite our MD and CEO, Radhika Gupta, who has been at the forefront of bringing new and innovative ideas to the Indian market, whether it's alternate investment funds to start with, and then the big one with the Bharat Bond, the debt passive target maturity segment, wherein we are the leaders at this point in time. So without further ado, I would invite Radhika to the show and to start this session and share with us her feelings and her thoughts at this moment, and to talk in brief about the product at hand.
So good evening, everyone. Thanks, Deepak, and thanks to everyone who's joined. I think the launch of actually India's first debt index fund, and the many people who've written into us also with a lot of enthusiasm about this launch. Kya ho raha hai, kya aa raha hai, how do I learn more about it? So I guess through Deepak today, you'll learn everything about it. I think maybe I can start with some of the genesis for this product. As you said, I think the first product in this space that we brought to market was in partnership with Government of India, and that was Bharat Bond. And I think what Bharat Bond did is provide people a very simple, and I highlight that word, a very simple fixed income product that delivered a few things. One, it delivered safety in terms of its quality of portfolio, and we all know how important that is. Secondly, it delivered liquidity. It was an open-ended structure. And thirdly, through this unique target maturity structure, and we can talk about it again, it delivered predictability of returns. So it was a buy and hold structure where if you bought for a certain number of period, you knew that in that period, you would get the return of the index. And that structure became very, very popular, and it became known as the target maturity ETF structure, and people have made that a large program. We thought that why not expand that program? Why not take the structure of Bharat Bond that has worked for everyone, which is the target maturity structure, but expand it to another very high quality basket. And the new basket here is half AAA PSU, so the universe that everyone has liked, and half is state development loans or SDL, which I'm sure Deepak will talk about. So, to describe this product in summary, it's a long-winded name as you were trying to sort of talk it through, but I think the name really explains the three facets of the product. It is a target maturity index fund. So it has got a defined maturity, and it is a passive fund, which means it is a low cost passive fund that has an underlying index. We can talk about the index, and its aim is to follow the index to the best of its ability. So that's part one. The second is the product has the word 2026 in it, which means it's a target maturity fund. It buys bonds and holds them till 2026, April 2026 approximately. So if you are a hold to maturity investor and you're investing till April 2026, you're likely to realize something close to the index yield. And the third is it has the name PSU and SDL in it. So it's a basket of approximately 50% PSU and 50% SDL. So that I think is what the product is in summary.
So great, Radhika, like always, you have uniquely explained the product with its nomenclature itself, like you did during the MSCI launch. That's quite unique and very simple for most of us to understand that it is an index fund. It has a target maturity. The underlying happens to be PSU and SDL. But talking about target maturity, if you can throw some more light, because there may be some participants who may not have participated during our Bharat Bond program, what problem does a target maturity address, and what exactly it means by target maturity? I mean, will the fund cease to exist? Will people get their money on their own, and so on and so forth?
So I think the biggest problem or the biggest need that we have in bond investing, Deepak, is that इन हिंदी एज वी से कि कितने टाइम में कितना मिलेगा. आई थिंक व्हेन यू गो इनटू अ बैंक एंड यू डू एन एफडी यू नो दैट इन एक्स इयर्स आई एम गोइंग टू गेट एक्स परसेंट एक्स वाई जी परसेंट वट एवर दैट इज. आई कॉल दैट प्रॉब्लम प्रिडिक्टेबिलिटी ऑफ रिटर्न. And I think, see, you don't care at some point, right? For 3 years or 5 years, I'm going to get X percent. Now, whether the US economy does this, whether RBI does this, whether the governor does this, this should all be, whether interest rates move up, whether interest rates move down, I have a certain predictability of return. That is the problem target maturity fund solve. If you are an investor who is investing for the holding period, the yield you will get is what the index yield is. Now, how does a target maturity fund solve this problem? I think the simplest way to think about a target maturity fund is to think about it in comparison to a basic bond. When you invest in a bond, say you invest in a bond of NHAI and the principal is 100 rupees and you are supposed to get 6-7% interest a year. So you are going to get for 5 years, 5 coupon payments of 7% each plus some accrue on one of them. So you're going to get 35 plus something, say 40 of interest and another 100 rupees of principal, and you're going to get that back. And in 5 years, you're going to get this back regardless of what the RBI does. So that's how a bond works. And we all understand bonds. A target maturity fund basically holds a collection of bonds and holds them till maturity. So it may hold 15 bonds, it may hold 20 bonds, but it holds them to maturity. That's essentially what a target maturity fund does. And it solves this problem, as I repeat, of predictability of return.
Great, Radhika. Talking about target maturity, and invariably one talks about Bharat Bond, and perhaps for ages people will keep talking about Bharat Bond and compare all other future offerings with that massive offering that you all did. So Radhika, how does this new product of yours, which is an index format, compares to Bharat Bond, which is an ETF format? So why do you think that an index format perhaps is a better a solution for investor than an ETF format? Or there are two different baskets, one has its own merit and the...
But I think the question was, how does the format of this product compare to the format of Bharat Bond? And let me come to that question. So there are three parts to keep in mind here. The first part is Bharat Bond was an ETF because that was a government mandated ETF, and an ETF is a product that trades on the exchange, and you need to have a DMAT account and you can buy and sell ETFs on the exchange. So the ETF format is basically a format where you can buy and sell on the exchange. And then recall Bharat Bond had a fund of funds format which invested in the ETF. What we realized in our feedback from individual investors is that people actually prefer the mutual fund kind of format rather than the ETF format. There's nothing wrong with the ETF format. They just prefer the mutual fund format, which is why we brought the index fund format this time. Recall our MSCI launch on the healthcare side was also an index fund. So that's the reason for the index fund format. Both are passive, low-cost vehicles. It's just that this is very similar to a MF format. You don't need a DMAT account. There's no buying and selling on the exchange. By the way, you can do all the mutual fund things that people like to do, SIPs, SWPs, etc., into this format. I think the other two points with regards to comparison on Bharat Bond. One is that the structure is very similar to Bharat Bond. As I said, Bharat Bond had a target maturity structure that continues to hold. The second point is the basket is different from Bharat Bond. Bharat Bond had a triple APSU basket. This is 50% triple APSU and 50% SDL.
So Radhika, you mentioned SDL, PSU basket very well. We have explained it during our Bharat Bond launch. What is this new mix that we have brought in, SDL? If you could explain that and some of the myths that surround it.
Sure. So SDL is a word we're less familiar with, but actually we should get familiar with SDL. And maybe later we'll talk about why we included SDL. So SDL basically stands for a state development loan, and everybody is familiar with GSEC. So GSEC is essentially the borrowing of Government of India, right? And it's done by RBI. SDL is the borrowing of various states of India in the form of bonds. So just like Government of India borrows in the form of bonds, states of India borrow in the form of bonds. These bonds are also auctioned by Reserve Bank of India on the same basis and in the same manner as GSEC. And they actually share very similar characteristics to GSEC. So the coupon rate for each state is decided in the auction process. The RBI runs the auction, semi-annual interest, et cetera, et cetera. the Meta point, and by the way, they are also eligible like GSEC for SLR investments. The Meta point of this is SDLs have a sovereign rating. They do not carry credit risk. They carry zero risk weight, which is similar to GSEC and T-bill. So it is essentially the borrowing of states of India in a program that is auctioned by RBI, carrying zero credit risk. That is very simply what SDL is. And SDL is basically issued by states to finance the gap that they have between their revenue and expenditures.
So if I were to simplify, these are state government securities. You know, when we talk about GSECs, we talk about central government securities. SDLs are essentially state government securities backed by RBI.
Absolutely. So the state equivalent of a GSEC.
So Radhika, we know that the greater, the higher the level of safety, lower are the returns. And that's why perhaps we never, chose government securities and we chose AAA PSUs. And now we are choosing SDL. So if the rating profile of SDLs is higher, don't you think the returns will get compromised?
Yeah. So this is an interesting time to launch a product, Deepak, with SDLs. You are right. Typically, when you look at it, because AAA PSU carries a AAA rating, SDL carries a sovereign rating. And we just talked about SDL versus GSEC. Typically, the way the yields are, you have GSEC, then you have SDL, and then you have PSU in terms of yield. What's happening today, because of the large supply of SDLs, because of the borrowing program of states, the yields on SDLs are actually higher than AAA PSUs, even though their credit quality is better. They are sovereign versus AAA PSU. So from an investor point of view, we felt it was a good time to launch a product that was a blend of both, because you're getting a very good risk-adjusted return. You're getting better rating and you're actually getting a higher yield, not because it's going to be structurally higher or because there's more risk, just because of the amount of borrowing going on today.
So is it an equivalent of a timing where large caps are essentially cheaper at some point in time with regards to, let's say, even mid caps, though over a longer period of time, large caps should not be delivering as high as returns as mid caps? Is it that equivalent? Is it a good example to quote?
Yeah, it's actually a combination of two things. It's one, generally, because yields have gone up, equity levels are cheaper in the bond equivalent parlance. And yes, in that category, large caps are relatively better priced than mid caps. So SDLs tend to be relatively better priced. So it's the absolute level of yield is good, and the relative level that you're getting in SDL versus PSU is also good.
So in short, can we say that this actually enhances the credit quality of the portfolio as well as the return quality of the portfolio?
Absolutely.
So great, Radhika, but it must be coming up with some degree of uncertainties. I won't call risk. Risk is too large a word. I think uncertainty is very, very simple to understand. What is the uncertainty, especially with regards to liquidity, especially on those SDLs that we spoke about? Do you think that they are as liquid as, let's say, government securities or AAA PSUs?
Okay, so SDLs are not as liquid as GSEC, which is why they don't carry. I mean, there's a reason that SDLs also pay higher interest rate than GSEC. There is some relative illiquidity. I don't want to get into the technicality of how SDLs are issued versus how government bonds are issued. But relative to GSECs, they're a little less liquid. Relative to PSUs, they're a little less liquid. However, the reason we picked the basket, I think, Deepak, is very important to think about. In normal times, PSU, AAA PSUs, and we've had enough experience on the Bharat Bond side, are very, very liquid. SDLs are a little less liquid. There are times when markets get extremely panicked and there is a flight to safety, and SDLs tend to be a little more liquid than AAA PSUs. So we felt the combined liquidity of the basket actually hedges each other out, and it works quite nicely. You've got two sets of bonds that are high on credit quality and slightly inversely correlated on liquidity risk.
So on normal case basis, they are a little less liquid, perceived less liquid. But in times of crisis, they actually turn out to be more liquid because of the SLR nature of the portfolio. That's really interesting, Radhika. It kind of provides a hedge in the portfolio, both in terms of return as well as liquidity. That's really interesting. So Radhika, why not launch a portfolio which is, let's say, perhaps 100% SDL, which can take your returns higher? Why is it that we need that element of 50% of CPSEs?
So I think we think the combination is good. And Deepak, it is also important for us to move gradually in every direction. I think you made a point that in normal circumstances, we do feel that having AAA PSUs, and by the way, we are very experienced on the liquidity of AAA PSUs. We run a 30,000 crore program. We've seen 1,000 crores of subscriptions, redemptions every day. That works really well. We thought introducing this SDL component in gradually brings a nice sort of hedge into the portfolio. And that's why we thought it would be a gradual movement from AAA PSU to a 50-50% blended portfolio. I think that was the logic. And the incremental delta of pure SDL versus AAA PSU, I think the trade-off worked really nicely in this 50-50 portfolio.
That's really great, Radhika. Let's get to basic, simple questions which every investor would like to ask. In a product like this, if I were to stay invested for 3, 4, 5 years, or as you know, for the entire maturity, what are my payoffs vis-a-vis a, let's say, a traditional investment on either on fixed income mutual fund side or say fixed deposits for that matter, both gross return and post-tax return, which is very, very important for most investors?
So let me talk about gross return first. And in the meantime, I'd request you guys to load the slide that talks about net return. So on gross return, if you look at the index has 20 securities, and in a 2026 period, you should realize an index yield of about 6.4%. So that's your gross return minus your expense ratio and taxes will come to give you your net return. Now let's talk a little bit about net return. Let me talk about the tax treatment first, and then we can go to this slide. So the tax treatment on this index fund is very similar to, it's identical to debt mutual funds, which means that you have indexation after 3 years. Just to simplify again, indexation is basically that whatever the return is, say it's 6.2 after expenses minus the prevailing rate of inflation, assume that's 4%, that's in this calculation, on that amount you'll pay 20% tax. After all taxation, if you look at this slide, basically you're talking of a headline return of shade under 6%, so 5.97% post-tax, compared to a traditional investment where the tax case is about 3.84. So as you can see, Deepak, there's actually a very material delta on a post-tax basis versus a traditional investment. The absolute yields are good. The post-tax case is even better.
So am I to assume that you are going to give me more than 60% post-tax returns compared to a traditional investment for same maturity? Is it correct, Radhika?
Yeah, and you're a good sales guy to phrase it that way, but that's the right math. So if the traditional investment is 3.8, then this is closer. This is about 2.5% more than that. Yes, 2% more.
That's really awesome. But the problem, Radhika, for most of the investors, you know, when they invest in a debt mutual fund, is that the entry point, they know the YTMs, etc., and they make their calculations. And unlike FMP, invariably the rate, the final returns could be different because rates fluctuate and the NAV obviously fluctuates. Whereas in case of, let's say, an FD or a bond, you know that if you have entered at 5.4, you are going to get 5.4. How does it work if interest rates were to move up? And we have seen the cycles, you know, turn the corner in last couple of months. How does it really work?
So I'm going to give you three scenarios, and I realize this is a very important question because a lot of investors and partners have seen a sharp rise in interest rates, as you said, in the month of February. And thanks for pulling up that chart. So let's just talk about three scenarios. One is, Deepak, you are a hold to maturity investor, in which case we, as I said, you get the index yield, which is 6.4. So that's not your problem. Now, let's look at a case that you put on this slide, which is that you are a 3-year investor. And just to explain this slide and take a few minutes, what we have in the left column is a hypothetical yield movement. So the green one is if there is no movement in yield, as I said, this is assuming a YTM of 6.3, you can do 6.4, whatever it is. So there you're at 6.3. Now I want you to look at the column, which is the row, which is one above that, which assumes that interest rates move up 1% over 3 years. This is quite a significant movement in interest rates, Deepak, given where we stand today and that we've seen a rise in interest rates. I would just want you to turn your attention to the last column here, which is 3-year CAGR. Even if interest rates move up by 1% today over 3 years, because of the accrual and despite the little bit of MTM loss that you're going to get, you will still earn above 6%. That's 6.12%. That's actually better than a three-year investment today. So a three-year investor is actually very well off in this. That's the worst case scenario. We've also shown you examples of 50 BIP, 70 BIP, and of course, a fall in interest rates, because none of us can predict what happens to interest rates. I would also caution Deepak that in the very short term, 6 months, 1 year, if there is a rise in interest rates, there could be mark-to-market losses and the interest is not going to be enough to compensate. So this is not a liquid fund. This is not a short-term fund. This is not a low-duration equivalent investment. In summary, if you're a hold-to-maturity investor, nothing to worry about. If you're a three-year investor, the odds, even if interest rates rise, that you will be very well off are very clear. And if you're a short-term investor, then definitely wrong product.
So Radhika, what could be a possible risk to this hypothesis? What about the reinvestment risk, Radhika?
So reinvestment risk, Deepak, exists in all target maturity funds. It existed in Bharat Bond and anything, where any coupons that you have are going to be reinvested at the prevailing rate. There is some amount of drag that comes. We've seen this in Bharat Bond, though it's not a very large amount. It's typically 5 to 6 basis points.
But don't you think that during a rising rate environment, in fact, the reinvestment becomes much more profitable because you will be reinvesting at a higher coupon rather than a falling rate environment where your total returns would be lower actually compared to a rising interest rate environment?
Yeah, actually, you're right there. So if you're investing and you've got a higher interest rate environment, you're investing coupons better, at a better yield. So you'll get a 5% positive drag. And that's why I said drag could be positive or negative. Now, the mind works in such a way that we want to imagine the most negative side. So, when we think about total capital gains, we want to talk about interest rates rising. But when we think about coupons, we want to think about lower interest rates.
So, Radhika, let's just jump into, since it's a passive product, it is an index fund. If you could talk about the index method in brief, not really getting into too much of technicalities, how would the portfolio look like? In summary.
Yeah, and I think you have a quick slide on this, but it's a very simple portfolio. It's meant to be a 50-50 AAA PSU and SDL index. So AAA PSU is, of course, highest rated PSU. I think that's a construct that all of us are very familiar with. If you look at the first half of the table from NHPC to PFC, you see 10 AAA PSUs. They've got a little less than 5% weight. The balance 50% is split among 11 states. And again, it's states on liquidity weightage and borrowing weightage. So it is the best states that you see in the portfolio, which is why you see states that you recognize. So this is approximately what the index looks like. 50-50 index maturing in April 2026 with a duration of about 4 years, split equally into these. So it's a very diversified basket as well.
So is it really great, safe to assume that from a post-tax perspective, it even beats RBI bond, which currently yields you 7.25, but it's fully taxable. So is it fair to assume that it's a 5.70 to 6% post-tax, the range, post-tax product on a five-year basis, which compares with any safe investment much, much better than what's available in the market?
Yeah, so it is, I think it's a safe investment. I'll come to RBI bonds. It's an investment with predictable returns. So as you said, I think 5.7 to 6 is a very good post-tax range to keep in mind. And Deepak, it's also a liquid investment. I think, with due regard to a lot of traditional investments, this is a liquid investment. I think a lot of people have also asked us, are there loads, etc. I think after 1 month, no loads, entry, exit, and liquidity, even in our past issues and things like Bharat Bond, has never been a challenge. So it's also a liquid investment, which is important. I think in fixed income, liquidity is important.
Just getting to the final few questions, and then we'll start taking the audience questions, Radhika. On the product, Radhika, when does it, open for subscription, when the NFO closes, exit load, et cetera. If you can talk about it, that will be very useful for our participants.
Yeah, so the NFO is actually open effective today morning, and it closes on 16th. So of course, we'd encourage everyone to participate. And I think it's available through all financial advisors. So please talk to your financial advisor or whatever platform there is and let us know if we can assist you. I think, Deepak, your second question was on exit load. There's a minor exit load.
So 0.15% for only 1 month, just to discourage large flows between the month.
Yeah, and after that, there's, as I said, after 1 month, there's no exit load. And then I think your third question was cost.
Yes, Radhika.
So cost will be approximately 15 basis points in the direct plan and 30 basis points in the regular plan.
30 basis point in the regular plan.
Yeah, absolutely.
We heard that some liquid funds charge that kind of a expense.
Yeah, actually, even
the pandemic.
30 in regular is really slim. And I think, you know, it's important for investors to realize that this is, you know, a moderate interest rate regime. And one of the benefits of passive funds is that they are very efficient for an investor in terms of cost.
We have you here, Radhika. What's your, you know, view on how do you see this entire space on fixed income, you know, panning out for the next 3-5 years? And what would be Edelweiss's role and vision for themselves and investors alike for the next 3 to 5 years?
Okay, so I'm going to give an answer that might get me into a little trouble. But I really think fixed income in some way was already being run in passive strategies, right? Investors in fixed income in India were originally FD investors, right? They sought answers to those two questions I asked. In how much time am I getting what? The most popular fixed income products happen to be, Deepak, FMPs and roll down structures, which are basically target maturity structures run in actively managed funds, right? Nothing wrong with that. If you're running passive strategies, why not run them in passive funds with passive transparency at passive costs? And I think that's what this product intends to do. That's what Bharat Bond did. And I think, you know, one of the things people underestimate with the benefit of the passive business is, and there's this whole debate about active versus passive. Equities, you know, you can still debate the story. I think in fixed income, we believe there's a strong case for passive because passive brings low cost, transparency, and liquidity, all three of which are most critical in fixed income investing. You can debate their merit in equity investing. In fixed income, you can't. So we definitely want to do more in this space. We keep getting ideas from advisors and investors, which I would encourage you to keep coming. And, you know, we'll definitely bring out more ideas in this space, both on the target maturity side and even other stuff. And if there's something you want to hear from us, know. But I think for the end investor, this is a very, very good outcome. They're getting a very clean FD-like experience with the mutual fund tax efficiency at not very much cost.
A tricky question again, Radhika. You already have an approval for 2027 maturity. Why didn't you launch it along with this product? And why this particular time to launch 2026?
Okay, so I think we got two approvals for approval efficiency. We wanted to do this one, see the market response and also deploy it quickly and responsibly, after which we'll do the 2027. And that's what we thought. Both 2026 and 2027, and this is not marketing for 2027, come at a good time because ever since we've been planning to do this, interest rates have actually risen 1%. So I'm very happy our entry-level investors are actually going to come in at the yields that they are going to come in. And hopefully with everyone's love, blessings, and support, we'll do well in 2026 and bring 2027 to you fairly shortly.
So I'll start taking some questions from the participants. I have those questions coming to me directly. Some questions are with regards to SDL liquidity, which you have already explained. This question asks, what sectors does SDL finance? Does it infra, power? So what is the objective of raising SDLs in basic?
And, you know, SDLs are important because and it's not sectoral. SDLs are basically there, if you think about SDLs, to finance the gap between a state's revenue and expenditure. So states get some revenue from GOI cash transfers, right? But the actual expenditure of a state, if he's doing capital expenditure, actually far exceeds his revenue collection. And so this gap is typically funded by issuing bonds. And these days, with the amount of capex and development that states are planning to do, the need for state government-led borrowing is in any case very, very high. So that's the short answer on why SDLs are issued. And different states, of course, issue SDLs depending on their own fiscal conditions.
So, Radhika, this is a question which somebody has asked. This product is giving 6.3% by holding for next 5 years with interest rate bottom out. Is it likely to go up in the coming days? In such a situation, low duration funds are positioned well to adapt quickly to new bonds with higher rates. And 5 years is long enough period for this to happen. Will I not lose by sticking to 6.3 versus low duration short-term funds?
So the good question is, see, I think you're looking at two products with completely different goals and time horizons. Low duration funds are meant for a low duration, which is typically 6 months to 1 year. What a low duration fund will give you over 5 years, I have no idea. I don't know what interest rates will do over 5 years. I don't think anyone can reasonably give you an outcome. I think this product is clearly intended for a target audience that is looking at a 3 to 5 year investment, not a 6 month to 12 month investment. And at some level, you know, just like you gave the equity market analogy, we have to stop trying to time everything in life, right? If you're getting an absolute decent level of yields and you know that broadly 5.9 to 6% post-tax is a good amount of return I want to lock in for this period, I should be comfortable with it. Could this return go up and could your entry point be better 7 days later? Yes, it could be.
So Radhika, a lot of...
Yeah, but low duration is a very different category is all I would say.
Absolutely, absolutely. And one is hoping for the rates to go up and the yields too, whereas there is a definite, you know, it's like comparing an FD. Once you enter an FD, you get that return only.
Yeah.
That the floating rate FDs are not really available in the manner they should be available. But good question, nevertheless, Radhika, and well answered. Can we compare this entire spectrum of target maturity and specifically this particular offering from Edelweiss to a corporate bond fund with a roll down or a banking and PSU debt fund with a roll down?
Okay, so again, I'll get into trouble. There are two kinds of corporate bond and banking PSU debt funds. And I know you asked about roll down, but let me still make the difference very clear. The first type is one that is not a roll down and typically carries duration. And duration of corporate bond funds is typically 2 to 3 years. So that's a very different construct because it doesn't have the predictability of returns that we've talked about. Now let's come to roll downs, which are a popular strategy. Roll downs are essentially target maturity strategies. Roll down funds are buying bonds and holding them to maturity. I have no problem with the strategy. I just think it is, and we run one of these, right? It's a passive strategy in an active format. The passive platform may be a better platform for investor transparency because in a traditional roll down fund, with all due regards, there is no guarantee that the fund manager has to follow that strategy. Here you have an index, and regardless of what the fund manager wants to do, he has to follow the roll down strategy. What you see in 7 year roll downs is 3 years later, the fund manager decides, oh, the fund is depleted. I don't need to follow a roll down strategy. So I think this just brings a lot more transparency. The second thing is, Deepak, you don't need to go looking at which scheme of which AMC is doing what roll down. And we intend to have a series of this. I think one of the things that's worked for Bharat Bond is you have a full ladder, and you know, you guys go on Bharat Bond in and you like the ladder and you can invest. We intend to bring that kind of ladder and transparency here also.
It's like the GSEC ladder that we already have.
Exactly.
Great, Radhika. So this is a question with, I'm sure a well-wisher has asked, what is the target size of this fund?
So firstly, I am not adept to answer that because you are the head of sales. So you should answer what the target size of the fund is. It's too early to talk about the target size. I think the market response is very good. And we have never obsessed about target sizes of NFOs, especially in open-ended funds. I think we've always seen perhaps that our funds have grown significantly larger after their NFOs. I think Bharat Bond raised 22,000 crores in its NFOs, but it's a 31,000 crore program today. So I believe if you put out a good product for the investor, it will find its feet and it will grow. Thank you. This one's receiving an enthusiastic response. If you want to comment on target size, by all means.
It being March and budget setting being already in process, I don't want to talk about targets, but to be fair to investors, I think there's a large interest among various sets of investors, whether retail, HNI, corporate. And in next 4 to 6 months, we see this strategy gaining a real good size somewhere in the vicinity of 5,000-7,000 crores, maybe more. We have seen a lot of people telling us that no one in India buys long bonds or long dated funds. But today our 30-31 maturity products put together are 19,000 crores. So we are the largest manager of long bonds in India. Even the medium maturity bucket has grown into size, and within 6 months, it's close to 7,000 crores. So there's no reason why 26 maturity with a higher return via SDLs should not be anywhere into that vicinity. So having said that, and having had to revise my budgets, thank you so much for whosoever asked that question. Moving on to the next question, Radhika. This is again with regards to reinvestment of coupons. SDLs generally pay twice. PSUs pay annually. And also the question with regards to matching maturity. If you can answer all these two concerns, I'm sure you have understood the question. If you can clarify that, it'll be very useful.
So I think the first question is around how coupons are going to be reinvested. So coupons are going to be reinvested as received, Deepak, whether they are annual or semi-annual. Now, there is a positive or negative drag depending on the rate at which you reinvest coupons. We are all assuming in worst case that, you know, you invest them at lower rates because interest rates fall, then there might be a negative drag. If you invest them at higher rates, there might be a positive drag. I would re-emphasize the amount of that drag is not very large. The second question was what, Deepak?
With regards to target maturity and matching maturity of underlying securities.
Right. So I think these are reasonably liquid bonds and the index is constructed in a way so that it is a liquidity weighted index. So that is important. Of course, we are not going to get everything that's matching maturity, but we try to get as close to matching maturity as possible.
So Radhika, the question is, if SDL and GSEC are both sovereign, why is there a difference in yields? Why is there a difference in yield between the two products?
So the difference, and I'll give a slightly more technical answer here, the difference in my view is on account of a little illiquidity. See, prima facie, SDLs and GSECs carry similar credit and risk characteristics, but SDLs have a large number of primary supply. Now, this is just minorly technical. When the government of India issues bonds, and by the way, this fragmentation is an issue we've studied a lot in Bharat Bond. When the government of India issues bonds, it tends to reissue the same bond many, many times until the amount outstanding is a particular size. So you actually have very few bonds outstanding and they are of size. States, however, just keep issuing new securities. By the way, corporate bonds used to do this as well. This means that there are thousands and thousands of little SDLs outstanding and there's not consolidation. So there's a little more illiquidity versus GSEC, and that's actually present in the data. So it's not a credit related issue. It's a little bit of a liquidity related issue.
So basically, you know, fragmented holdings, fragmented issuances, perhaps GSEC is only around 80 or 100 odd issuances and these run into 5,000 or more.
A few thousand crores, 4,000, 5,000.
The next question is, how well can you differentiate this strategy with a bond fund with 100% GSEC? Is it more better in terms of risk and liquidity perspective?
Okay, so you have to look at three parts to this. One is portfolio. You're saying 100% GSEC, so that's a sovereign portfolio. This is half sovereign and half quasi-sovereign. So it's pretty close. You'll get better yields than GSEC, of course, because it's SDL than this. The more important thing is chances are your GSEC fund is not a target maturity fund. It carries duration. So that means the return is not predictable. We also have a gilt fund, so we know what that entails. This is very importantly a target maturity fund. So it's meant for an investor with a certain goal. It starts at a certain maturity and it's a declining maturity. That, in my view, is a far more critical difference than any difference between credit. And the third is very likely cost. If it's an actively managed fund versus this, I think the cost would be significantly different.
Great, Radhika. This is a question from somebody who understands the complexities with regards to index. Given the bond index fund structure, can replicability be a challenge in context of Indian bond markets?
Okay, we've got some very evolved investors here. So it's not a challenge in context only Indian bond markets. Indian bond regulations and bond ETF regulations and index fund regulations follow global regulations. So broadly what happens, let me just compare equities and bonds, and I'll try and not make this very technical, but still. In equities, if you have a portfolio of Nifty 50 in the index, you replicate it exactly, right? And that's possible. You can buy all stocks. In bonds, if I have an index that says, you know, I am going to have an index of all bonds maturing in 2025, within the last 6 months of April 2025, hypothetically, I might have hundreds of bonds in that list. Now, nobody can go out and buy all 100 bonds because 100 bonds are not liquid. And this is not just in India, it's all over the world. So regulators issue guidelines for index funds called risk replication guidelines, or in India, they are called waterfall guidelines, which basically says that if I can't find an identical bond in the index, I'll substitute it with a bond of identical credit quality and duration. So that's broadly what we follow. We've been following that approach in Bharat Bond, and quite frankly, it's worked really, really well. All target maturity funds follow it, and we'll follow it here.
So Radhika, this question with regards to ETF and index again, during Bharat Bond, we obviously have enough resources to put market makers to provide liquidity. Why didn't we choose that route and chose index fund instead?
See, this is a product where we got a lot of feedback from individual investors. And Deepak, I think you remember during the Bharat Bond issue, we issued the fund of funds program to buy ETFs. Now, bond investors are not demat account holders. I mean, equity investors maybe, bond investors are not demat account holders. And they also don't need, especially in a long-term product, you actually don't need the fee. You don't feel the need to use the ETF feature of intraday buying and selling. Actually, very few people use that feature. Most people do end of day. And people like the convenience of a mutual fund portfolio. Some people, by the way, want to do SIPs into the stuff. So we said, why not just do an index fund format? Worked on the equity side for us. Why not do it on the fixed income side? Practically, actually, we're bringing the same convenience that we brought in Bharat Bond to FOF investors and index fund investors.
So also, we keep it clear, Bharat Bond on ETF format, anything else that we do
on index fund
would primarily be on the index format to keep things simple and differentiated. This question is, and let me answer that, there is no credit risk with regards to SDL. If someone really wants to go and research, go to RBI's website, and there's an FAQ on the definition of government securities. In that, state development loans and SDLs are mentioned as GSEC. They're also form part of SLR exposure for banks. Also, when banks make investments, they have to provide credit risk weightage. For government securities, T-bills, and state development loan, the credit risk is zero. Let me again mention zero. For AAA PSUs, it is 20%. And for mutual fund, it ranges between 100% to 250%. So the environment, the RBI's website, the fact that the interest payment, the issuance, the principal payment comes from the consolidated fund of states maintained by RBI. And the issuance also happens via RBI, like central government securities. It is a sovereign security issued by a sovereign state government within the Federation of India. So Radhika, the next question is with regards to future offerings of such nature. Would you also venture down the private sector route in terms of underlyings?
Good question. We have certainly thought about it. We would want to explore it, but we would never want to compromise safety or liquidity in anything that we do. So once we feel that we can conduct and create a private sector index that is of high quality, where we feel comfortable with the portfolios and comfortable with the liquidity management, why not? I think we have been early players in this segment, but we also want to take gradual and manageable steps. So I don't know if I answered your question, but that's the direction. So of course we're exploring, we want to explore. I mean, you know, I'd venture to say that we want to be leaders in this space, we want to be innovators in this space, but we want to do it very responsibly.
Before I take the another question, it is an open-ended fund. Once it's open for regular subscription, one can redeem or invest like any other mutual fund on a T+1 redemption cycle basis. Radhika, this is a question with regards to deployment. How would you source the assets? Is it from primary market or secondary? What is your idea behind it? Both from an NFO perspective and on ongoing.
So it's largely going to be secondary sourcing. Of course, if there's any bond auctions going on, just like we participate in Bharat Bond or anything else, we will bid in the respective auctions. But primarily, it is secondary sourcing. And of course, our investment team had comfort in this tranche and in the securities. In fact, we've put together a prima facie portfolio of securities that we are going to be able to replicate. And we feel the situation is quite comfortable. And we expect to deploy very shortly after the funds are raised. But it will be largely secondary.
Radhika, you're calling this India's first debt index fund, which we get it. Are there any mutual funds which are primarily dedicated or have some kind of an SDL exposure available in the market? This is a question. We can take it or we can perhaps leave it.
The challenge is, my friend, I how many? There are some 19 or 14 categories, as you tell me, of debt mutual funds, and there are some 44 asset management companies, plus there are many closed-ended funds. So for me to remember, I don't think there's one that mirrors the structure exactly. I don't think there are many target maturity funds and roll downs. If someone does it, I may have forgotten, but I haven't seen a structure or a popular fund like this. Let me put it that way. So, and there are lots of mutual funds, Deepak, for me to run through, and I reasonably don't have such a large brain.
But I think so that, you know, some of these, offers that we see, or filings that we see on SEBI, some people are trying to, you know, look at in various formats on the passive side. I would encourage people to look at that. We may not have all the right information to share. This question is, Radhika, it's an interesting question. It's an, sometimes you can call it, it's an, you know, oranges to apple comparison, but let's try and answer that. If one was investing for 3 years today, how do you compare this SDL plus PSU product with Bharat Bond 2030? Which one do you recommend?
2030 will have significantly more duration than this. So they are actually very much apples to oranges. So now if you're investing for 10 and 5 years, your outcome is clear. Over 3 years, which one is going to be better is a function of where duration and interest rates move. So if interest rates move up a lot more, then this one is going to be better. If interest rates move down, that one is going to be better. I mean, that's the short answer. But it's really like comparing apples and oranges. Typically, if you're investing for 3 years, you should not pick a very long horizon product.
Let me add to that. If you really want to invest for 5-6 years, then yeah, that product may make more sense, simply because the carry is very high at 7-10. Even if there were to be reverses of similar nature of 1%, 20, 30 or 31 can give you better 6-year returns, but they will also hurt you very, very, largely when the rates, move up. So it's better to look at, 5-6 year kind of a product for a 3-4 year investment or more, and a 5-6 year investment or, a product for a 8-10 kind of a maturity bucket product, not for 3 years. So Radhika, last question. How do you think that this entire SDL market, because of the fact that a lot of people are trying to, offer these spreads, are they going to remain where they are, or will you see some reversion to earlier era where SDLs used to be trading at lower than PSUs in terms of yield?
See, back in April, SDLs were trading at lower numbers than PSUs. So can that happen? That can certainly happen. Now, as far as all these products are coming up, there are just a couple of products coming up. And unless all of you are so supportive and there is a huge amount of money, I think given the amount of state borrowing that there is, you might be in a situation. I don't think this amount of money, and by the way, this is not the only investment from mutual funds that goes into SDLs. There are regular active mutual funds that buy SDLs, et cetera, et cetera. But our sense is, given the borrowing requirements of states and the fiscal needs of states, this will continue to be elevated for some time in the near future.
There's one more question. If the maturity is pegged at 5 years, isn't it a better idea to invest in a BAF?
I love BAF, and you're asking me to compare two children of mine. So that's an unfair question. But I think they are very different parts of your asset allocation. BAF is definitely part of the hybrid or equity part of your asset allocation. This is the fixed income part of your asset allocation. So generally, one should not compare apples and kiwis. I think there's some money that we have and some goals that we have that we want to take risk on. And I think BAF is a great fund for that. I mean, I'm like a BAF beast. But there's some goals that we have that are 3 to 5 year goals where we want absolute safety of capital, and this would meet that. So different products for different needs.
Thanks, Radhika, for taking time out and answering all the questions that we had for you and all the participant questions. We really believe that we have been able to address most of the queries. But if you still have more questions or more suggestions, do reach out to us on our website. We are available on Twitter. We are also available through our 23 branches and our 80 salespeople across the country. Do reach out to us. We are available 24/7. Yes, 24/7. We work with a startup kind of mindset. Do reach out to us. We'll be more than happy to answer all your questions. With this, we come to the conclusion of the launch call for Edelweiss Nifty PSU Plus SDL 2026 Index Fund.
I just want to say a thank you, Deepak. I was just told by the team that hundreds and hundreds of people have joined the call. So it was in really large numbers, which is why we saw the number of questions. So thank you to the hundreds and hundreds of people who joined. And that person who asked that question about the NFO size, please identify yourself privately. I'm going to send you a gift from my end.
Thank you so much.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.